make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. Heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Hold me and make me, this is what I pray. Change my heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. Let's sing it once more. Change my heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Hold me and make me, this is what I pray. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you.
Amen. Well, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let him just mold you into what he wants to make you into. Praise God. Brother Jonathan, would you like to open us up in a word of prayer? Yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. As we worship, let's just worship him with everything that we have. He's worthy of it. Amen. Amen. Feeling so much better.
Feeling so much better. Talking about this good old way. Feeling so much better. Talking about the Lord. So let's go on, let's go on. Talking about this good old way. Let's go on, let's go on. Talking about the Lord. The devil, he don't like it. Talking about this good old way. The devil, he don't like it. Talking about the Lord. So let's go on, let's go on. Talking about this good old way. Let's go on, let's go on. Talking about the Lord. Feeling so much better. Talking about this good old way. Feeling so much better. Talking about the Lord. So let's go on, let's go on. Talking about this good old way. Let's go on, let's go on. Talking about the Lord. The devil, he don't like it. Talking about this good old way. The devil, he don't like it. Talking about the Lord. So let's go on, let's go on. Talking about this good old way. Let's go on, let's go on. Talking about the Lord.
Amen. Let's keep talking about him. Amen. Let's make devil mad. Let's talk about the Lord. At Calvary. Who remembers that?
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing not it was for me, he died on Calvary. Oh, mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned. Then I trembled at the law I spurned. Till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. Now I give in Jesus everything. Now I gladly owe him as my King. Amen. Now my raptured soul can only sing of Calvary. Oh, mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary. Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gold that God did spend at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary.
One more time.
Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burden soul found liberty at Calvary.
We wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for Calvary. Hey, never forget Calvary. That's why we're here. Amen. When the saints go marching in, who's looking for that? Amen. A little loud. Amen.
I'm a pilgrim and a stranger, wandering through this world of sin. On my way to that fair city, when the saints go marching in. When the saints go marching in. When the saints go marching in. Lord, I want to be in that number. When the saints go marching in. Oh, I know I'll see my Savior. If my life is free from sin. Heaven's doors will open for me when the saints go marching in. When the saints go marching in. When the saints go marching in. Lord, I want to be in that number. When the saints go marching in.
close within. I'll be shouting glory, glory, when the saints go marching in. When the saints go marching in. When the saints go marching in. Lord, I want to be in that number. When the saints go marching in. I'm waiting for the chariot to swing low and I'll step in. On the clouds I'll ride to heaven. When the saints go marching in. When the saints go marching in. When the saints go marching in. Lord, I want to be in that number. When the saints go marching in. Amen. I can't wait for that day. Amen. Soon and very soon. Let's keep fighting.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. There'll be no more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. There'll be no more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see my King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
Amen, amen. Can't wait for that day. Amen, amen. Like just a change order of service, we have a couple announcements and prayer requests. Today is Brother Johnson's 90th birthday. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Also, let's not forget next Sunday, November 13th, our Thanksgiving potluck directly after service. So a week from today is the potluck directly after service. Come hungry. A couple prayer requests. Let's remember Brother Ron Husker in prayer. Just for God to move in his midst. His health is failing him. Let's also continue to lift up Sister Kathleen as well and Brother Marty. And also the election. Let's not forget that. That's coming up this week. And let's not forget one another and ones we haven't seen in a while. And the ones who are sick and afflicted, Brother Jonathan, Sister Cheryl, and many others. Let's just lift each one of them in prayer and let's just rise and let's just take these knees before the Lord and let's just go on one accord. Dear Lord Jesus, we just thank you, Lord, for this glorious opportunity, Lord, for you to hear these petitions, Lord. And Lord, we come here, Lord, because we know that you're a God who just honors faith and who answers prayers, Lord. And we're coming, Lord, for these needs for our sister Kathleen, Lord. You see the turmoil her health is in, Lord. It's no surprise to you, Lord. And Lord, we know you're going to move in your perfect timing, Lord. I pray, Lord, we just continue to unite in faith, Lord, for our sister's healing, Lord. You said in your word, if we would agree upon touching, if two or three agree upon touching any one thing, let it be established, Lord. And I believe we're all agreeing, Lord, for a healing, Lord. We're just waiting for the manifestation of it, Lord, and we're looking to you, the author and finisher of our faith, and we know you're going to answer it, Lord. I pray you bless Brother Ron Husker, Lord, this move in his midst as well, Lord. You see his health as well, Lord. I pray, Lord, I know in his heart he wants to be here so bad, Lord. I pray you'll make a way for him to start coming back, Lord. Just heal his body as well, Lord. Be with our Sister Cheryl and Sister Tasha, Lord, just to touch their health needs, Lord. I pray you'll heal them from head to toe, Lord. I pray also you be with any unspokens that we would have, Lord, in our hearts, Lord. You know the secrets of our hearts, Lord. And I thank you, Lord, just for all that you're doing in our little body here, Lord. I pray you just bless our unsaved loved ones, Lord. Just be with the service, Lord, today, Lord. And I pray, Father, we just want to unite together in faith, Lord. We thank you for each request, Lord. Be with the election that's coming up, Lord. I pray, Lord, your perfect will be done, Lord. And, Lord, we just want to just thank you once again, Lord. You're an amazing God. You're a perfect God. And we want to just give you all the honor and glory that you're worthy of, Lord. Just help us, Lord, day by day as we walk this Christian walk, Lord. Forgive us when we falter, Lord. And, Lord, once again, Lord, we want to just lift these petitions up before you as one body, Lord, in unity in you, Lord. Just help us, Lord, I pray. Just move in such a mighty way. We ask all these things, Lord, in your wonderful, most precious, holy name. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Sweetest name of all. Amen.
Jesus, you're the sweetest name of all. Jesus, you always hear me when I call. Oh, Jesus, you pick me up each time I fall. You're the sweetest name of all. Jesus, how I love to praise your name. Jesus, you're still the first, the last, the same. Oh, Jesus, you died and took away my shame. You're the sweetest, sweetest name of all. Jesus, you're the soon and coming King. Jesus, we need the love that you bring. Oh, Jesus, we lift our voices up and sing. You're the sweetest name of all. As we gather, may your spirit work within us. As we gather, may we glorify your name. Knowing well that as our hearts begin to worship, we'll be blessed because we came. We'll be blessed because we came.
One more time.
As we gather, may your spirit work within us. As we gather, may we glorify your name. Knowing well that as our hearts begin to worship, we'll be blessed because we came. We'll be blessed because we came.
Amen. You'll be blessed. Amen. Amen. That's why we're here, for him. Amen. Think on these things.
Whatsoever ever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things of good report, think on these things. Think on these things. Think think on these things. Think on these things. If there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Think on these things. Think on these things. Think on these things. Whatsoever things are true. Whatsoever things are honest. Whatsoever things are just. Whatsoever things are pure. Whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things of good report, think on these things. Think on these things. Think on these things. Think on these things. If there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Think on these things. Think on these things. Think on these things.
I love that song. Just think how good he is to you. Amen. Day after day, he's been faithful to us, hasn't he?
Day after day, you have been faithful to me. Day after day, I've known your grace. Day after day, week after week, year after year, I will declare your glory, I will declare your greatness, I will praise your name. He's worthy. Day after day after day, you are my Savior, my friend. Day after day after day, I'm not alone.
He's here for you.
Day after day, week after week, year after year, you will be right beside me. You will be here to guide me. I will praise your name. Day after day after day, you have been faithful to me.
Thank you, Lord.
Day after day after day, I've known your grace. Day after day, week after week, year after year, I will declare your glory, I will declare your greatness, I will praise your name. Day after day after day, you are my Savior, my friend.
Thank you, Lord.
Day after day after day, I'm not alone. Day after day, week after week, year after year, at me. You will be here to guide me. I will praise your name.
Let's sing that verse one more time.
Day after day after day, you are my Savior, my friend. Day after day after day, I'm not alone. Day after day, week after week, year after year, you will be right beside me. You will be here to guide me. I will praise your name.
Let's just praise him. Oh, Lord Jesus, we thank you, Lord. You've been faithful, Lord, to us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, Lord. We thank you for your grace and mercy, Lord. You've been so good to us, Lord. Even when we've been bad, Lord, you've been good to us, Lord. We just lift your name up on high, Lord. Every day you're here for us, Lord. You haven't left us alone. You promised not to forsake us nor leave us, Lord. We thank you, Lord Jesus. You're a faithful God. We owe you everything, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I'd like just to change the order of service. I'd like just to take the tithes up before the Lord. We could just rise. And Brother Ron, would you like to lead us in the tithes, my brother? Yes, Lord Jesus. Amen. I want to read a testimony that Brother Johnson gave us. He said, "Thank you for the prayers. The Lord was gracious as I went into the hospital last Sunday evening, plus received a pacemaker for my heart. God bless all of you who prayed for me." Well, it's a blessing to see our brother Johnson back in. We missed you. We've been praying for you. We give God the glory for bringing you back. Amen. Praise God. Amen. We'd like to just change the order and invite our precious pastor, Brother John, up just to bring us the word of life. And want to string. His strength is perfect. Amen. He's gracious. His grace is sufficient.
His strength is perfect. When our strength is gone, He'll carry us when we can't carry on. Raised in His power, the weak become strong. His strength. He'll carry power, the weak become strong. His strength is perfect. His strength is perfect. Amen. How many is thankful for the strength of God?
Amen.
Amen. Usually we see it when we are weak.
Amen.
And none of us want to be weak, but that's when we can really see the strength of God in our life.
Amen.
And that's when Paul seen it. And we're following Paul as he followed Christ. Amen. It's good to see each and every one of you this morning in God's house. It's so good to see Brother Johnson. And we're just grateful for doctors.
Amen.
And they help us. And when I originally heard that, Brother, nobody wants to be in the hospital, right?
Right.
And I had heard that Brother Johnson didn't want to have the pacemaker, and I'm thinking, no, Lord, it's not time. I want Brother Johnson here. And I'm so thankful that you got the pacemaker, and amen. We want to continue holding up our Brother Bruce this Tuesday, having a meeting. It's really, if you're thinking about your heart and surgery, this is life and death decisions. And our brother, I know, covets our prayers. Brother Gideon from Nigeria sends his greetings this morning, and Brother Daniel Darko from Ghana. So they're always praying for us in the little group we have here. Amen. We're going to be again reading here in the book of Matthew, chapter 25. Matthew chapter 25, if you want to turn there. And we want to remember Brother Jason DeMars, who's in Turkey right now. And actually, we want to remember all God's missionaries. Amen. Amen. All of God's people. Before we begin reading, let's look to the author. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that the doors are still open today. Lord, that the government has not closed them. Lord, that we have this privilege of gathering together. It was a sacrifice for all of us as far as getting up this morning and denying our flesh. But Lord, we count it an honor and a privilege to be in your house, to be with brothers and sisters of Light Precious Faith, to worship you. And Lord, you promised that where we'd just gather together, just two or three of us, you'd be in the midst. And Father, though the world is going insane and going crazy, we know that you're still true to your word and that your presence is here, Lord, regardless of maybe the outside senses declaring it, the inside sense declares it by faith. And we thank you for your presence here, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that you would remember those that are not here, Lord, today. Lord, that you'd remember our sisters that are sick and our brothers that are sick. Father, who would just desire to be here, Lord, if they could. And I pray that your presence would be right in their homes and their midst right at this time, Lord. May you meet with them and may they just know of assuredly that you're never leaving them, you're never forsaking them, Lord. Meet the needs that they have.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
Father, we thank you for what you did for Brother Johnson.
Thank
and
Jesus.
Lord, we thank you for blessing him these many years. And God, the lives that he has touched, the souls that have been saved, Lord, we cannot thank you enough. We cannot worship you enough. We cannot honor you enough. And we just thank you for moving and being in his life, Lord. And God, we ask now as we look into your word, and Father, may we glean just something here that can help us to be better Christians, Father. We commit the service with all of our needs.
and give us ears to hear what your Spirit is saying now. And we thank you in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Matthew 25, starting with verse number 31. This is maybe not as a familiar of a scripture that we would be used to, but we want to take a part of it and use it this morning for this message. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory and all the holy angels with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory, and before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them from another, as a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats, and he shall set the sheep on the right hand and the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto them on the right hand, Come ye blessed of the Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was a hungered, and you gave me meat, and I was thirsty, and you gave me drink, and I was a stranger, and you took me in. Naked, you clothed me, and I was sick. You visited me, and I was in prison, and you came unto me. And then shall the righteous answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee a hungered, and fed thee, and thirsty, and gave thee drink? When saw we thee a stranger, and took thee in, or naked, and clothed thee? Or when saw we the sick or in prison and came unto thee? And the king shall answer and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Then shall he say unto them on the left hand, Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was a hungered, and you gave me no meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you took me not in. Naked, and you clothed me not. Sick, and in prison, and you visited me not. Then shall they also answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee a hungered, and a thirst, or a stranger, or naked, sick, in prison, and did not minister unto thee? Then shall he answer them, saying, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye did it not to one of the least of these, ye did it not to me. And these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. I know it was kind of a lengthy reading. And this this parable really could be talking about Israel and the nations, whether they were good to Israel or not good to Israel. But I would like to take this and just, if I could, apply it to us in the aspect where the Brother Branham taught us that eternal life was living for others. And of course, living for yourself is temporal life. Amen? It's not eternal. I would like to speak on the subject of hell this morning. It may seem strange coming to church and hearing about hell, because this is, we want to hear about God and heaven. And they say that Jesus taught more about hell than heaven. I don't think that's true, but he spoke quite a bit about hell. And if he did, I don't know. I don't know what the prophet said about it. But I want to establish this morning that hell is a place. It's a real place that we come in contact with. Brother Branham talked about it being another dimension where the spirit of an unregenerated person goes to. And then underneath that dimension was where demons are. That was another sphere. And then underneath that sphere was hell itself. Now, hell sends its influence through many different channels, and then we see it here on earth. And the Bible talks about in this age that hell has enlarged itself, and we see corruption all around us. But I want to establish this morning the place of hell in order for to help us identify when it eludes us. Because I think a lot of times we don't recognize hell. Brother Branham said in the message, God keeps his word. He says, that song, Pass Me Not, used to be sung in a Methodist age where they had the Spirit of God on them. And the people would faint and fall on the floor. And preachers would preach hard about hell. People would scream and cry and run to the altar. And we Pentecostals believe that we have got something that they didn't have. He says, I think we ought to go back and get what they had. Amen. About 280 years ago, when John Wesley was just 38 years old, Jonathan Edwards preached a sermon called Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. He was a hell, fire, and brimstone preacher. My wife had read a little bit and had described to me, boy, this has been some time ago when she had told me, but the people who were there remembered that hell was so vividly described to them that the people could actually feel the heat from the flames of hell. That's how powerful it was. There are different names for hell. We've read Hades, the grave, everlasting fire, bottomless pit, the lake of fire that burneth with brimstone. So a lot of different ways to describe it. I'm going to be talking about something we never think about, because that's what I usually do. In the message, God's only provided place of worship. Brother Branham said, and then years ago, I seen the righteous, the regions of the lost, and I was there. And I tell you, friend, as an old man, let me persuade you this across the nation this morning. Don't never want to view that place. Amen. There's no way at all that I could. If I was an artist with a brush, I couldn't paint the picture. And as a minister, I couldn't describe it to you. Talk about hell being a burning place. It's a million times worse than that. The horrors that goes with it. Amen. Hell is not a place that to play around with. Yet we see many, many people doing it. True. One person described Jonathan Edwards as being hard. His harsh tone would push people away in today's world. Today, preachers preach that God is a loving God and he loves you even when you're in sin. People are more likely to join the church if the preacher uses kind words rather than hurtful words like Edward. The saying, you catch more flies with honey than with vinegar, is definitely true in this case. Now, this is what he said. If Jonathan Edwards were to preach today, I feel like he would turn away many people with his harsh words and horrific images of God throwing everybody into hell. You know, God hasn't changed, though. Hell hasn't changed. George Whitefield's message was simple. It was not enough to be baptized or to go to church. Right. Each individual must be converted by the Holy Spirit of God through a personal, wrenching examination of his or her own corruption and sinfulness. Amen. That's why Brother Branham said we come to church just to find out where we're at with him. Because he's still working on us. Brother Branham said in the message, Expectations, he said, that's what's the matter, Pastor. What's the matter? Our people will go to hell is just because you let down the gospel in the pulpit. That's exactly what it is. If you keep those little old rosary things out of the pulpit and preach the gospel, the power of God unto salvation, have an old-fashioned altar call and have people clean up their lives, it would be different.
Amen.
Brother Branham said, the Bible says hell was created for a certain group of people. It really wasn't created for humans. It was created for the devil and his angels. That's what Jesus said. It was prepared for the devil and his angels, but it wasn't never created for evil men or just evil women. The Bible says that that none would be lost, that all would be saved. That's God's desire. So he really didn't create hell for bad people. It was created for the devil and his angels. Revelation 20, verse 10 says, and the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophets are and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. That's his place.
Right.
Now, with that being said, the majority of the humans go there. The majority of the humans go there. Jesus said, more go into the broad way.
Right.
Yeah. Only a few find the straight, narrow path.
It's
Galatians 5, 19 through 21, we're not going to read it, but it states that individuals that do the works of the flesh cannot inherit the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
And that's why if humans don't get a nature change, then by default they go there. Hell was really created for a particular group of people who just don't care. These angels, they left their first estate. Well, where are they going? God created a place for them. God prepared a place where beings could go and be alone without God. It's a sad. But if you just think about it, they didn't want to be with God.
Right.
That's why they left their first estate.
Right.
And what is the problem with human beings that are born? Nobody's born with the Spirit of God.
Right.
Nobody's born with a nature of God outside of Jesus Christ.
Right.
And he was born by God himself. And so every human being has to come to the place of my nature is not fit for heaven.
Right.
My nature is not right, so I've got to change it. And people don't want to deal with that. They want to talk about how good they are and that you're no better than I am. And some try to do it through works, or some churches believe in praying so many prayers or giving so much money or doing so many things, and things, you know, change their outcome for heaven. But it's not true. A man has to be born again.
Amen.
You can't get around. Jesus said, unless you're born again, you can't see the kingdom of heaven. So where does that leave us? Hell. And I'll just say this to us young people and anyone that's gotten baptized. When you reach that age of accountability, it is your responsibility to get a nature change, to start living for others.
Amen.
You know, baptism isn't just means everything's okay now.
Right.
No, that's when your responsibility really, really begins.
Amen.
Brother Brandon made mention in the message, stand still. He said, I'd rather have it than anything I know. I wonder tonight if you would let all the hustle and bustle of your mind, the confusion, everything that's in your mind, if you just stand still just a few minutes and let God talk to you.
Amen.
See, if he don't tell you, you're wrong.
Right.
I mean, that's what the Holy Ghost does. He'll come and he'll lead and guide you into all truth, right?
Amen. That's right.
Oh, you say, I belong to the same church my mother did. Well, that has nothing to do with it. Hell will be made up of church members.
That's true.
Amen.
He said, that's right. Unless a man is born again, when he is born again, the life of God dwells in him and the fruits of the Spirit follows, which is love, peace, and joy, long-suffering, goodness, meekness, temperance, patience. He becomes a new creature in Christ Jesus. He's a part of God. He's a son of God.
Yes.
Now, on earth, humans can do whatever they want to do and still have a little hope that they're going to go to heaven.
Right.
Because they haven't died yet.
Right.
And that's why they can just resist, and they don't care about maybe being faithful at church or doing the things that God wants them to do. They kind of do what they want to do, and yet they feel a security. It's a false sense of security, but they still feel a security that there's still hope that they're going to go to heaven. But did you ever notice when somebody is facing death? Then they begin to look at things differently.
Yeah.
Amen.
Because they're running out of time.
Right.
Hell is a place where there's no hope. There's no hope. There's no chance of hope.
That's
this people don't realize it. Remember the rich young ruler who was in hell or Hades?
Right.
It's a place of the departed souls. Brother Branham says when a soul dies without Christ, it goes into a fifth dimension. And he talks about this in the countdown. He's caught between two things in the fifth dimension. He's got a soul, and it cannot go into the presence of God because it's not covered by the blood. He's a sinner. He cannot wake up because his time on his time's up on earth. So there he is in this torment nightmare. Now, you've all been in a nightmare before where you just, I don't want to be here. I want to get out, and you're trying to get out, but you can't get out. Well, that's what this dimension is for those that die without Christ. They're like lost. They don't have any place to go. Their time is up on earth. They can't go into the presence of God. So it's a constant torment. And that rich young ruler. The Bible says that there was a great divide, that he could not go unto Abraham and or unto Lazarus, and Lazarus couldn't come to him. There was a divide there. And to me, the greatest torment about hell is knowing that there's no chance of life again.
Amen. True.
Probably the hardest thing for humans to deal with is death.
Right.
It's a separation. You're forever not going to talk to that person again down here on earth. That is a hard thing to deal with. And when there is a second death, though, right? And this is, you don't have a, well, maybe I'll talk to him in the third. There is nothing after that.
Right. Amen.
People are facing death. They are forced to think about that their life wasn't spent thinking about pleasing God or doing his will. And that's what they think about at death. I didn't please God. And that's what brings a man to repentance. That's what brought that man on the cross to repentance. But notice there was another man on the cross that just mocking it. Did not. He was so caught up in the dimension of hell, as it were, that there was no conviction. And hell can really grow. It can, a man can become so spiritually filled with God that God could turn the world upside down with him, right? But a man can become so filled with the devil, so filled with hell, that he just doesn't care.
Right.
Hell is really a place of individuals who chose not to care about God's will. That's what it is.
Right.
That's what it is. They all got that in common. They chose to do their own will. So we can easily define hell as a place of I don't care. And I'd like to entitle this message this morning, The Place of I Don't Care. The whole world is displaying I don't care. They just don't care about anything. When they saw the corruption that was in the FBI, they just didn't care. They were mocking them. They just mocked it. They don't care. They don't care about what's going on all over the world. They don't care about the corruption. It's sin is just right in your face, and they don't care anymore.
Right.
It all started with Lucifer. He was the bearer of light.
Right.
He was the cherubim that led all of heaven in worship. Now, his calling wasn't only to lead the worship. God had set Lucifer to protect, defend, to hedge, to fence in, to cover over, to join together. His job was a protection. But he lost his care to bear the light of God, and he chose rather to bear his own light. But we know his light just leads to death.
That's right.
Right? It's a light, but it leads to death.
Amen.
He stopped caring about God's will. It's how simple it was. He stopped caring about God's will for his life. So I say the place of I don't care was originated in heaven by Lucifer himself. It was really discovered by Lucifer in the presence of God. He was in heavenly places. And that's where it started. That's why we could sit right in church where there's security.
Right.
And the devil could still be speaking to us. God made a perfect being and showed him his perfect will. God's perfect will for his life. But he also made him with free choice.
Right.
He didn't say choose either or. He didn't do that. He made him perfect. This is the will of God. That's all there is. But something happened, right? Ezekiel 28:15 says, thou was perfect in the ways from the day that thou was created till iniquity was found in thee.
Amen.
Iniquity was found in him. It must have been something that was self-concocted. Right? Because
right.
I tell you, God don't do anything bad. Everything God created was good, the Bible says. Now we can consider ourselves a pretty good Christian, but remember this, iniquity can be found in us.
Yeah,
true. Amen. Isaiah 14:12 says, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart. So it doesn't matter what your lips are saying. This is a heart communication. I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the mountain of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
Amen.
O Lucifer lost his care about the will of God.
Right.
He lost his care about the total will of God.
Right.
He wanted to do his own will.
Right.
His life was now going to be free from God's input. Didn't have to worry about him. You know how we were when we wanted to leave home? Don't want to be under our parents anymore? Come on. Don't tell me you didn't have those thoughts, feelings. Some of us even said, I can't wait to get out of here.
Right.
Well, that was Lucifer. He couldn't wait to get out of there. A life separated from the will of God. Verse 15. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit, to the place that's been prepared for those who want to live without the will of God.
Amen.
The place of I don't care about God's will in my life. Hell is truly a place of I don't care. Verse 16. They that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider, is this the man? Notice they're calling him a man. Is this the man that made the earth to tremble, that did shake kingdoms? Wow. Well, I'm telling you, our nation is being shaken.
Right.
And I know devil's behind that. That made the world as a wilderness and destroyed the cities thereof and opened the house and opened not the house of his prisoners. That sounds like the devil.
Yeah.
Come on, come with me. I'll give you a good time.
Yeah.
And then he locks you down and he throws away the key.
Amen.
That's him. The man. I just think this is ironic that he's calling him a man. Revelation 13:8 says, here is wisdom. Let him that understandeth count the number of the beast, for he's the number of a man. See, it's the same number. And his number is 666. Well, we understand through the prophet that means instead of the Son of God. And really, in simplicity, it's instead of God's will. It's our will instead of God's will. And that's why they're the same. That's what Satan wanted. He wanted his own will instead of God. It's the same thing that man wants. That's why it's hard to get people to come to church and hard to talk to them about changing their lives, because they want their life instead of God's.
Right. Amen.
Notice, I will. It all started in his heart. And then it went to his lips, where he persuaded angels who loved the idea of doing their own will just like he could. A life free from doing somebody else's will. It's almost like the idea, be your own boss, work your own hours. You heard me tell the story when I started out. I remember about midnight working on a surface grinder, just talking about, oh yeah, be your own boss, work your own hours. Like it's real easy.
Yeah.
It's not that easy.
This
was all the beginning of the place of I don't care anymore. Hell is filled with iniquity.
True.
He that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. Without a doubt, men and women are more in love with themselves today than ever before. Do you believe that?
Amen.
I believe that. Brother Branham said in the message, I'm going to five quick quotes here. In the message, the angel of the Lord, Brother Branham said, iniquity is something that you know that you ought to do and will not do it. Hell is really a place of I don't care.
True.
That's what that is. In the message, be certain of God. Brother Branham says, what is iniquity? He says, is something that you know to do right and don't do it.
Amen.
Behold, a greater than Solomon is here. What is iniquity, he says? Iniquity is something that you know that you're doing that you ought not to do and still won't repent. Wow. Hell's getting a little bit closer. Does God ever change his word about his, change his mind about his word? Brother Brandon says, what is iniquity? Is something that you know you should do. That's the right thing to do. And yet, you don't do it. See? What is going to be in the last days? In the message, Power of Transformation, iniquity, he said, iniquity is something that you know that you ought to do and you won't do it. He says, you know better, but you won't do it. It's iniquity, see? Now, this is really coming close to home, because I just wonder how many of us know certain things that we should be doing, and yet we just kind of don't put that much interest into it, that much effort into it, because we think we understand what's really important. The place of I don't care. It's hard for people to notice iniquity in their life.
Right.
It's elusive. It's deceptive. It's mysterious.
Right.
It's a seductive spirit that makes people feel justified as they're doing it.
It's true.
It's a lot easier for us to recognize a spirit of I don't care or an attitude of I don't care than it is to see iniquity in my life. And that's why I'm going this route. Because we can see that a lot more. In fact, we even talk about it. We even say the words like, oh, whatever. Sometimes it can really come out.
Right.
And we need to be careful. We need to be careful, because what we're dealing with, this place of I don't care, is really hell.
Right.
People can easily get to the place where they just don't care about certain things anymore. And it grows into other things and bigger things. And it seems that it'll get to a place that even affects their spiritual walk.
Right.
Do you believe that?
Amen.
We know, according to the messenger of the first church age, that the mystery of iniquity was already working. It was working with all deceivableness in them who lost a love for the truth.
Amen.
They lost that love for all the truth. And that's why Jesus told them in that first church age to return. You've left your first love. You need to return to that love. And in this last age, iniquity has gotten so strong that it has affected the way believers treat one another. Amen. How they care about one another. Jesus said in the last days, because iniquity would be soaring and abounding, that the love of many would just simply wax cold. Everybody knows what wax looks like when it's cold. Everybody has candles. And it can't do any good. You can't form, it's got to be warmed up. And if love is cold, it ain't worth having.
Right.
All because people have an I don't care attitude. People have stopped caring about others.
True.
They've taken on a huge I don't care behavior. I call it a place of I don't care. It's not a place we want to be. It's not a place that we even want to visit,
right,
let alone live in for a period of time. Iniquity or an I don't care attitude really has a direct hindrance on the manifestation of perfect love. And Brother Branham says, whatever you do, get perfect love.
Amen.
So you can't, those things can't simultaneously be together.
Right.
I don't care attitude or iniquity is what really has filled hell with. That is the thing that all the demons have in mind. They don't care what they got to do to see you tormented. They just don't care. They don't care how you feel. They don't care if you don't sleep at night. They don't care what you're going through. They don't care about your finances. They don't care about your sickness. They laugh. They just don't care.
True.
Brother Brandon refers to the cup of iniquity not being quite filled yet. Revelations 18:4 says, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins and that ye receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God have remembered what? Her iniquities. That's what God's remembering. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her double according to her works in the cup which she have filled to her double. This is a serious situation. But can I talk about the good part about this right now? Good part about hell? It's not really a good part, but the part that Satan gets us to look at. There's love and iniquity. Iniquity can be simply defined as 100% selfish love. There's love. Every human is born in sin and shapen, as it were, into a selfish love.
Amen.
And we understand that. Anybody that's got children, they want their way all the time. You never sit down and you say, look, you've been doing everything that mom and dad's wanted you to do for the past 5 years, and now it's time to start doing things for yourself. It's just the opposite. It's like you can't get across to them. It's not your will that matters. It's your mom and dad's. We're born with 100% selfish love. Even if you know to do good, you still don't do it.
Right.
How many times you tell your child to do this, you turn around and see, it's a spirit of I don't care what you say, Mom. I don't care what you say, Dad. I don't care what you say, Pastor. I don't care if the prophet said that. I don't care if the Bible says that. You got to care.
Right. Amen.
That's a spirit. It's a seductive spirit.
Right.
If it's written, man shall live by every word of God. It's got to be important.
Amen.
Heaven is filled with perfect love.
Amen.
There's nothing selfish about the love of God.
Right. Amen.
That love is all about God. And it's all about keeping his commandments. Just to get a little bit better understanding of what I just said, the Bible says that we're to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our might, and Jesus talking and answering a man that asked him about what's the greatest commandment. He said the greatest commandment is to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart. And the second, he said, is like unto the first, which is to love your neighbor as yourself. Well, we know how we love ourselves. We were born with that love. Nobody has to tell us. But to love somebody else that way, where you're going to do everything you can to make somebody happy. People don't really know what living for others really is. We all have an idea. We have an opinion. But I'm telling you, heaven's living for others. That's right. All heaven, the angels are rejoicing over one sinner that repents. Amen. Heaven is thinking about others, and hell is thinking about itself. Amen. It don't care. In fact, it'll go out of the way to stop anybody from getting saved because it's jealous. It knows it's doomed, right? Amen. And it wants to take as many down as it can. And if you think about it, you've all experienced this. You missed it. You missed the mark. You know you did. You're coming to grips with it. You're so mad you don't care anymore. You want to make somebody else miserable. You ain't getting what you want, so the whole house is going to be upset. Everybody's going to know about it. Brother Johnson used to say, you go one day without prayer. The wife knows about it. You go 2 days, the children know about it. You go 3 days and the dog knows about it. And sometimes you get to a point you just don't care anymore how you're treating people. The prophet said nothing but perfect love can enter into that place. Brother Branham described eternal life as living for others in this present life.
Amen.
So if eternal life is living for others, then this temporary life is living for ourselves. Wow. Now, you know, the thing is, if we could just be honest with ourselves and take time to really analyze, am I just living for myself? Well, Brother John, I've got to work. Brother John, I got to, you know, I didn't ask you to stop working. I just asked you to start living for someone.
Amen.
Well, you're just getting personal with me. Well, God, the Holy Spirit does do that. He's pretty personal.
Amen.
Well, I don't think that's the Holy Spirit. I think that's you. Well, then you need to find a church that you believe that who's ever preaching is the Holy Ghost preaching to you. Because if you got to sit there and say, well, is that's not God, that's a man, you're going to be in a very, very lost condition of ever getting the leadership of the Holy Ghost for your life.
Amen.
There's a vast difference between doing things for others and living for others. One is simply supplying the eggs while others supplying the ham. And just so you know, I looked at the list for Thanksgiving, and nobody has filled anything in about the sliced ham. Brother Mark's laughing because he had dinner with us the other day and we had sliced ham. Amen. Heaven is filled with love for others. Hell is filled with love for self. Believe it or not, they both have love. Hell is often associated with hatred. Well, hatred, if you look at the definition of hatred, is just a lesser love.
Right, true.
When you love yourself, it's very shallow.
Right.
There's a beginning to it, and there'll be an end to it. But God's love is eternal. There's no beginning. There's no end. And we learn about it in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Hell is filled with love for self. And if it's filled with love for self, then it's a place filled with selfishness.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Selfishness.
Amen.
Selfishness is being concerned excessively or exclusively for oneself or one's own advantage or one's own pleasure or one's own welfare, regardless of others. Selfishness.
Right.
Hell is filled with self-seekers,
right,
while heaven is filled with seeking others.
Amen.
Hell is filled with self, and heaven is filled with others.
Amen.
What's on hell's mind? Self-concern.
Right.
That's what the devil's always trying to got Cain. You know, Cain, if you just get Abel out of the way, you know, you will be number one. What did he tell Eve? Just, you know, you could be just like God. She lusted, right? She lusted. That's what the spirit that we're born with, it lust,
right,
for what it wants.
Right.
She lusted for knowledge. We lust for our will, whatever we want. It's about self-concern. It's whatever you want. But heaven is concerned about others. Has been. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. I used to know a story. I haven't heard it in a long time. But it was like in hell, they only got, their forks were long. They were like, I don't know, 9 feet long or something. And they could never feed themselves from the end of it. And they all just suffered because they were too selfish to feed one another. They never learned to feed one another. I'm telling you, this thing called selfishness is a place of hell.
Amen.
One thing people don't think too often about is living selfishly.
Right.
Some people go through life, as it were, like with a catcher's mitt. And they just catch the blessings of God. Thank you, Lord. That's all they do. They never learn to throw the ball at anybody. They never learn to throw a blessing towards somebody. It's all about how much God is blessing them. I don't want to go through life with a catcher's glove. I want to be the one pitching the ball. I want to be a blessing to everyone. Jesus taught us to even be a blessing to our enemies.
Amen.
Think about our opening scripture here where the whole view was about living for others.
Yes.
And Jesus said, when you live for others, you're living for me.
Amen.
But you don't got time for others. That's what it was, why they didn't go do it.
Right.
They didn't make time. And that was selfish of them. It was a love for themselves.
Yes.
No matter what the devil told them, when the end came, they went to the place they chose they wanted to be.
Wow.
Think about it. That's why Jesus said, all that come before me are thieves and robbers, because they still want their own will. They want to go to heaven, but they want their own will. And you got to give up your will for God's will.
Amen.
You got to deny yourself.
Amen.
Crucify yourself.
Yes, sir.
Mortify the deeds of your body.
Amen.
That was the only remedy that Jesus gave. You want to follow me? Look, this make it clear. You got to deny yourself on a daily basis.
Yes.
That nature is not going away on its own. I don't care if we get baptized, we speak in tongues. I don't care what happens. If we don't learn to crucify ourselves every day, there's no way we'll live for others.
That's right.
I don't care how much tithes you pay. I don't care.
Right.
You've got to die in order to live for God.
Amen.
Selfishness is the very nature that embodies us from the time that we were born. What gets us in all of our troubles. And I know, turn with me if you would to James chapter 4. I know we've been through this scripture a few times in our past services, but I really want us to those of us that are being just really honest with ourselves, I believe this can be a blessing to us and help us to see that the real evil battle that's happening in us and how we can overcome. Verse 1 says, from whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence even of your own lust that war in your members? Ye lust and have not. Ye kill and ye desire to have and cannot attain. Ye fight war and ye have not because ye ask not. Ye ask and receive not because ye ask amiss that ye may consume it upon your lust. In other words, it's all about you. Ye adulterers and adulterers, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? This is how the world operates. You know, I hope it's okay to say this. If not, please correct me. There was a big thing that came out about Black Lives Matter. And I believe Black Lives Matter. I believe all lives matter. But the thing is, there seemed to be that spirit behind it, is that our life matters more than anybody else's.
Sure. Yeah.
And I'm not saying everybody that said that had that, but it was an, I don't care about you, I care about me.
Right.
And the whole world is full of this. It's to be a friendship of the world is an enmity with God.
Right.
So whosoever will be a friend of the world is an enemy of God. Do you think the scripture saith in vain, the spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy? That just means ill will, which any will that's not God's will is ill.
Amen.
And you notice, this is not talking to evil, unbelievers, unconverted people. Yeah. That would, if it, this is not... this is talking to anybody who finds themselves lusting for anything that isn't God's perfect will.
Right.
So, but listen, we could fall in that category all the time. We could. That's why we need to walk in the Spirit, not fulfill the lust of the flesh.
Amen.
But it's not far from us. It's the Scripture is for us.
Amen.
It may not be, as it were, I'm saying the state that we're in right this second, but we've all experienced this, and we're coming here to learn how to defeat that enemy inside of us.
Amen. Amen. That's right. Amen. Amen.
Hell is the place of I don't care, and I believe it's closer than we think.
Right.
How do we get out of this place? That's the key. How do we get out? I want to stay as far away from this place of I don't care, this attitude of it doesn't matter. And he gives us an answer right here in verse 6. I believe humility was the very character that Lucifer left behind.
Yes, that's right.
We don't know how long he was a cherubim and covered and did his job to protect everybody. We don't know. It could have been a long, long, long time. So during that time, he must have remained humble. Because God, the Bible says, God dwells with the humble.
Amen.
That's where he dwells. He dwells in a high and lofty place, but obviously he dwells with them as a humble and contrite spirit also.
Amen. That's right. Amen.
And he expects humility when we come into his presence. We know that because Isaiah, the prophet, who was called to be a prophet from his mother's womb. When he got into the presence of God, humility was required.
Amen. Right.
And that's what got favor with God. Amen. What got favor with King Ahasuerus? So sorry. It was the humility of Esther. Where Vashti, she didn't feel she needed any humility to come into the sanctuary, to come into God's presence,
right,
to come into the king's presence.
Right.
Like, you owe me this, and half of it's mine. And the Bible says I'm a joint heir, and, you know, your promises are mine. The preacher said, claim them, and I'm claiming them. But you got to do it with the right spirit. you got to have the right approach.
Amen. That's right.
Verse 6 says, he giveth more grace. but he giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resist the proud, no matter how much they claim it. He resists the proud, but he giveth grace to the humble, unto the humble.
Amen.
So what do we do? Submit ourselves, therefore, to God.
Amen.
Submit yourself to the will of God, and then you're able to resist the devil who's enticing you to do what you want to do.
Amen.
Don't you wish sometimes the devil would just leave you alone? The key is spend some time submitting to God.
Amen.
He knows. He knows the battle. He knows what you're going through. He knows what you're fighting.
Amen.
And we want to help, but he wants us to spend more time humbling ourselves.
Right.
Verse 8, draw nigh to God, and he'll draw nigh to you. What a promise.
Right.
What a promise. That doesn't mean show up for church. It doesn't mean, you know, just go through the motions and give an offering.
Right.
No, drawing nigh takes effort.
Amen.
You just didn't, you know, walk out of your bedroom, outside the door, and you were in church. No. You had to get in your car and watch where you're driving, and some of you drove a long, long way to get here. Drawing nigh can take time. Look at that. Was it Daniel who prayed 21 days before he got an answer? Sometimes we can't even make it to prayer meeting. Sometimes we don't want to take time during the day. Just a little. God, where's your answer? I know I don't deserve one thing from God. It's by the grace of God. So drawing nigh to God takes effort. This is the way he describes it. James describes it. He said, cleanse your hands. Cleanse your hands. Purify your heart. Don't be double-minded. Get on track. Stay on track.
Amen.
Oh, my. I want to read this. Brother Branham said that in the message, Getting into the Spirit, he says, they jump right out of the frying pan into the fire. You find that people will come right out and they'll start to serve God. And the first thing you know, they go right back into the world again. Double-minded. You got to make a decision. Got to stick with it.
Amen.
Drawing nigh to God requires being afflicted, mourning, weeping. Let your laughter be turned to mourning. Let your joy to a heaviness. Humble yourselves. He's going back to verse 7 now. It's all part of it. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. And then, not your brother, not your sister, not a family member, but the Lord shall lift you up.
Yes.
Our strength cometh from above.
Amen.
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 So how do we get to this place that we need to be? How do we get away from this place of I don't care? Humility.
Amen.
If you think about people who are in this place of I don't care, you see pride written all over them.
Yes.
All over them. They don't care what you think. They don't care how you feel. They just don't care. I say flee that place. Flee from every thought that doesn't care. Flee from the flesh, from the selfishness, from pride, from thinking that you're better than someone else or that someone is a little bit less than you or somebody's got a problem. You know, you don't got to ever be spiritual to know somebody's got a problem. All you got to do is listen to the devil. He'll tell you. But you know, you do have to be spiritual in order to help somebody.
Amen.
You got to have a heart of I care. A heart of, I'm going to give up my time, my life. I will search for answers. I will work day and night, and I will help. But you first have to leave this place of I don't care. Someone asked Brother Branham one time, he says, what can I do to get rid of my greed, my selfishness? Brother Branham gave the most simplest answer.
He said, just take everything you got and start giving it away. Just give it away to everybody. Wow. That was pretty much the same thing that Jesus said to the rich young ruler. He had the same problem. He didn't want to give it up. The I want. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19. It says, nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal. The Lord knoweth them that are his. And let every one of them, every one of God's, every seed of God, let every one that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. That word depart, it means to remove from, to revolt against, to detest it, to desert it, to refrain from it, to withdraw thyself from it. The very thing that was created by Lucifer, God's seed, God's elect, God's bride, is fleeing, is departing from, is learning to get that I don't care attitude away from them. You know, there is a way that seemeth right unto a man. But we know where that goes, right? It's the ways of death. I'm almost done. This place, if I don't care, it don't belong in our church. It don't belong in God's people. God's people are really serious about this. They're constantly humbling themselves under the mighty hand of God. They don't do it just here and there, but they're constantly searching. As George Whitefield said, they're examining their own corruption in sinfulness. And I believe the bride is departing from that place more and more of I don't care. She's becoming so much like her bridegroom, like the groom, that she's learning to live for others, to lay down her life for others. She doesn't care about what this world can give her. She's making God her head. He's always first. His will is always first, just like it was in heaven. Jesus told us to pray that his will would be done here in our earth, just like it is in heaven. Brother Branham tells about this story, and Jesus keeps all his appointments. And I just want it to really ring home with us today. He says, the time is at hand, and look, the door will be closed after a while, and you'll cry to get in and can't. I talked to a young woman some time ago. I was holding a meeting in a Baptist church, and I asked her that night to come to Christ, and she wouldn't do it. And then afterwards, she met me outside and said, don't you ever embarrass me like that again. A year later, I passed through the street, and she was horrible, young girl. She was an honorable young girl. I believe her father was a pastor. I passed through the street, and her underneath skirt hanging down, smoking a cigarette, going down the street, and she was a deacon's daughter. Might have been a deacon's daughter and a minister's daughter. And I said, hello there. She said, hello, preach. Such a slang as that. Hello, preach. I said, aren't you ashamed of that cigarette? She said, hey, would you like a little drink out of my bottle? She was half drunk. And I said, aren't you ashamed of yourself? And she said, come here. I want you where I stay. And I said, aren't you at home? She said, no. I said, well, what's the matter? She said, take a little drink out of my bottle and I'll tell you. I said, aren't you ashamed of yourself to offer me a drink out of your bottle or a cigarette? She said, I want to tell you something, preacher. You know the night you told me that was my last chance? I said, yes, I remember. She said, you were right. And
She said, since then, my soul has been so hard. I want you to think of that statement. My soul has been so hard. Now, here's the remark. It just runs shivers over my back, Brother Branham said. She said, I could see my own mother's soul fry in hell like a pancake and laugh at it. All because of an I don't care attitude. See, it starts out like not a big deal. But because it is the place of hell, it enlarges in our life. And it can get us to a place where we just don't care about people like we used to. And this young girl is own mother. And you know us, we love our children. But to get to that place where you just don't care. And it wasn't that she fell in love with the world or just despised God, but she got offended. She got offended because the preacher said, you got to get your heart right. And you know what? She sat in the church thinking it was personally Brother Branham calling her out. But it wasn't. It was the Holy Ghost. Amen. And so we need to take the word seriously. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Let's stand together. Psalms 86, verse 12 says, I will praise thee, O Lord my God, with all my heart, and I will glorify thy name forevermore. For great is thy mercy toward me, and thou hast delivered my soul from the lowest hell. Amen. God is in the delivering business. Amen. Amen. Let's sing, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. I don't want the Lord to pass me by. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. While another's thou art calling, do not pass me. Your prayer. Let me at thy throne of mercy find a sweet relief. Kneeling there in deep contrition, help my unbelief. Heal my wounded.
wounded, broken spirit. Save me by thy grace. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While another's thou art calling, do not pass me thou, the spring of all my comfort, more than life to me. Whom have I on earth beside thee? Whom in heaven but thee? Humble cry, while another's thou art calling, do not pass me by.
Amen. I surrender all. This is the way to humble yourself before the Lord, is just surrender your will to His. Amen.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him, in His presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. Well, all to Jesus I surrender, humbly at His feet I bow. Worldly pleasure all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender. All to Jesus I surrender, make me Savior wholly Thine. Let me feel the Holy Spirit, truly know that Thou art mine. I surrender Savior, I surrender all.
As she continues to play that, if we could just for a moment bow our hearts, close our eyes, and I want you just, if you would, with the help of the Lord, if you could just focus yourself being in the room alone with God. God speaking, God calling, God wooing, God longing to be closer, searching, asking you just to care a little bit more, to lay down your will a little bit more, to be concerned a little bit more. Will you respond to him? Will you say, yes, Lord, not my will, but thine be done. That's all he's looking for today. He's just looking for you to draw close to him, and he'll draw close to you. Lord, I pray for every heart here. Lord, you see our hearts, its condition, what you're calling us to, Lord. And Father, we're humbly surrendering our will to you. You see these that have come forward. Lord, you see these who surrendered in their heart and are surrendering right now, who are considering. Lord, I pray that you would bless them with such a joy unspeakable and full of glory. I pray that your love, Lord, would fill their hearts. Lord, that the only thing they could think about would be others, because you have supplied every need. You have satisfied every desire. You have met every need they had, Lord. And they're just so full of the love of God for others. Lord, I pray for any heart here, Lord, that's having a hard time, that is struggling, Lord, with their own will, and Lord, is having a hard time giving something up. I pray in the name of Jesus that you, Lord, you send your Holy Spirit right now and just break those bands, Lord. Yes. Break those chains, Lord. Set their mind at a confidence, Lord, with confidence that greater is your Spirit inside of them than the enemy that's trying to bind them to their own will. We denounce every spirit of the enemy, every lie of the enemy, every thought of the enemy, any selfishness. We surrender it to you, Lord Jesus. We surrender our lives to you, that you could use us, Lord, to live for others, Lord Jesus. Oh, God, just move in our midst, Lord. Every heart, every believer, I want you, saints, I just want you to believe the word of God that he has spoken to your heart personally now. Just believe it. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, we commit ourselves to you. We give ourselves to you. We lay down our lives to you, Lord. And we give you the praise for these things. In the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, the Lord of lords, the King of kings. For you truly are God and God alone. Your will is above every will. We love the will of God. We love your truth, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Amen. Let's sing that next stanza. Amen.
All to Jesus I surrender, Lord. I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power, let thy blessings fall on me. I surrender all, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender.
Let's sing it. All to Jesus I surrender now. I feel the sacred flame. Oh, the joy of full salvation, glory, glory to his name. I surrender. Savior, I surrender all. Amen. Change my heart, oh God. I want my heart changed every day. seems like through the course of the day, the devil, you know, gets in there. Amen. If the prophet said we backslide 100 times a day, we know that things are constantly changing. And may this be the desire and prayer of our heart every day.
Amen.
Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. No one else but him. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. You are the potter. I am the clay. Over and over, he molds me and makes me into his likeness. He fashions the clay, a vessel of honor I am today. And it's all because Jesus didn't throw the clay away. Over and over, he molds me and makes me into his likeness. He fashions the clay, a vessel of honor I am today. And it's all because Jesus didn't throw the clay away. Amen. How many's thankful for that?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Let's give Lord a hand clap. He's worthy. Amen. Amen. Mercy rerolled my life. Oh, it's hot. Well, you have to turn the air on because we're hot people. We talked about hell today. Got hot. Amen. Let's sing it. Oh, mercy rewrote my life.
Yes,
mercy rewrote my life. I should have fallen, my soul cast down, but mercy rewrote my life. Mercy rewrote my life. Mercy rewrote my life. I should have fallen, my soul cast down, the mercy rewrote my life. Amen. Let's sing. We'll give the glory to Jesus before we're dismissed. Amen. We'll give the glory to Jesus and tell of his love, and tell of his love. We'll give the glory to Jesus and tell of his wonderful love. We'll give the glory to Jesus.
and tell of his love. We'll give the glory to Jesus and tell of his wonderful love.
Amen. Now I want you to do one thing before you leave here. If you haven't done it, I want you to leave every thought, every attitude of I don't care here.
Amen.
When you leave.
Amen.
Because we want to keep it under the blood.
Amen.
And we want to march forward as new creatures practicing,
amen,
you know, what we heard. And the supernatural takes place in our life. Our character becomes more like his. Amen. But if all hearts are clear, we're going to be dismissed in a word of prayer. May the Lord be with you. Let's not forget our special Thanksgiving fellowship. We're really coming with the fellowship with the word, because that's why we come every time to church, right? But we don't come to fellowship with one another, Brother Brandon says. But I think next Sunday, we're really coming to fellowship also with one another and have some food. Amen. So, and if is it okay for others to bring somebody? Or I don't know what the rules are. Limited seating. But if there's that someone special that God put on your heart, amen, I think that would be just fine. All right. God be with you. God bless you. We're going to ask our brother Orlando. Is that your name, brother? God bless you. We're going to ask you to close in a word of prayer again. Amen. Yes, Lord. Grant it, Lord. Amen.